Well, good morning. How are y'all doing this morning? Doing wonderful, thank you. It's excellent to see everyone in the house of the Lord. Thank you so much for coming out and making Ebenezer a part of this rainy Sunday morning. Again, rain, it can be kind of inconvenient, but I tell you, we really need it. So thank you, Lord, for the rain. So again, I just want to thank everybody for coming and joining us. And I don't know about you, but I feel like our country is really at a crossroads. We're at a big-time crossroads over so many things that are going on. It's just kind of crazy out there, isn't it? But here's the deal. We have the answer, and the answer is Jesus Christ. So thank you for coming and gathering together so we can encourage one another, so that we can uplift one another, so we can get in our holy huddle, if you will. But let's remember, once we get done here, we still have work to do. Because when we get out of here is when we take the message to the world. And when we take Jesus Christ to where it is so desperately needed that people need the Lord. I haven't seen anything more stark to point out the fact that people need Jesus than I've seen in the last couple of weeks in our country. So do continue to be in prayer for our country, please. And I also want to ask us to remember Buck and Helen in our prayers. Helen is still having some health issues. They're trying to get things going to try something else to fix it, but it's a hurry up and wait situation. And in that entire time of waiting, she is continually having issues with blood pressure and back and forth from the hospital. So do please continue to pray for them. Yes, sir. Okay. Thank you, sir. We need to continue to remember Martha Arnett, who's been in the hospital with some fluid buildup issues, especially around her heart. Where is she, Bobby? Is she medical center? Okay. Just continue to remember those in prayer. And also our entire prayer list. If you want to pick up a prayer list on the way out, they're right down here on the front pew from our Wednesday night prayer meeting. So prayer is a powerful tool, folks. It's a weapon in our arsenal that is the most powerful thing we have. So we need to be men and women of prayer. So that being said, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we love you, Lord, and we again just thank you for the opportunity to gather together in your name, to sing our praises to you, Lord, to delve into your word, to worship you, and just to commune with you, Lord. We need you, Jesus, and we thank you for being here. Father, we have lifted up two precious saints to you for prayer, Lord. We just pray for Martha. Father, we pray for the doctors and nurses who are caring for her, Father. We pray for Helen, and again, pray for the doctors and nurses, and also for Buck, who's caring for her. And Father, we just pray that you will just help them to feel your presence in an awesome and a mighty way. Thank you, Lord, for being here with us. I just pray, Lord, that this is a time where you will be glorified and you will be honored in everything we say and do. It's in your holy and wonderful name we pray, Lord. Amen.
Good morning. Let's all stand and sing praises to our God, okay? Eternity. turned into wine. Open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you, none like you. Into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you, none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you, none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, and if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? What could stand against? Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God.
You might be seated. Good morning, everyone. And everybody on Facebook. Today we're going to be reading in the book of Matthew. We're going to be reading Matthew 25, 14 through 30. Yeah, it's a long one. Thanks, Nash. But for it'll be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted to them with his property. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1, to each according to his ability. Then he went away. He who had received the 5 talents went at once and traded with them, and he made 5 talents more. So also he who had 2 talents made 2 talents more. But he who had only received 1 talent went and dug in the ground and hid his master's money. Now after a long time, the master of those servants came and settled accounts with them. And he who had received 5 talents came forward, bringing 5 talents more, saying, Master, you delivered to me 5 talents. Here, I have made 5 talents more. His master said to him, Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a little, and I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master. And he also who had the 2 talents came forward, saying, Master, you delivered to me 2 talents. Here, I have made 2 talents more. And the master said to him, Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a little, and I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master. And he also who received the 1 talent came forward, saying, Master, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you scattered no seed. So I was afraid, and I went and hid your talent in the ground. Here, you have what is yours. But his master answered him and said, You wicked and slothful servant, you knew that I reap where I have not sown and gather where I've scattered no seed, then why you ought to have invested my money with the bankers. In my coming, you should have received what was my own with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to him who has the 10 talents. For to everyone who has will be more given, and he will have an abundance. But from one who has not, even what he has will be taken away. And cast the worthless servant into the outer darkness. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your scripture. Thank you for the promises of your word. Thank you for giving us the opportunity of being a good and faithful servant, using our time wisely, investing it in things that you find great, God. I pray that we use our time here on this earth wisely. I pray that when we do get to the end of our lives, we're able to say that we did live a good and faithful life, God. I pray that when we stand before you, you are able to say that of us, God. I pray that if that's not the case for us today, then we're able to apply whatever the message is today, that you're able to speak through Nash and change our hearts, change our lives, so that we may be living more according in your will, God. I pray this all in your glorious and holy name. Amen.
Let's stand once again.
Love, and I know it's true, and
And it's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you. I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You may be seated. Come to the part of the service where we remind people how you can still give to the church, give to God. You can go to our website and pay online. You can also use this thing to scan with a smartphone and give online. And we also have offering plates at the exits, so that you can go old school and drop a check in like I do. And we also have a place where you can drop checks just outside the sanctuary here. So let's go ahead and I'm going to pray, and then Melissa's going to play. Father God, we praise your name. We thank you so much for all your many blessings. Father, we come to you now. And Father, with everything that is going on in this world and in this country, Father, we ask that you would just take control. Lead us, guide us as we go through life, as we try to avoid the minefields that are in this life, Father. Help us to live for you and to show the world what you truly are. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. we went over this, and he looks over, and he's working on his smiling by turning around here and looking at me and laughing at me. But anyway, a lot of times whenever we think of hymns and praise and worship songs and offering up glory to God, a lot of times we think of it as old-time stuff and then new contemporary stuff that, you know, I think my contemporary started about 30 years ago. But if you look back on some of the newer songs that have been put out in the last 20 years, they are written from old hymns that were in our hymn books years ago. So many versions of Amazing Grace, and this particular song right here was written in around 1875, put to music around 1885. And it's not in our hymn book today for some reason, but if you go back to a Baptist hymnal from 1975, you find it in there. And all the writer did, all the artist did in the song, he used the words of that song, just changed music, and then he added a chorus to it. So pay attention to this word.
Skilled to understand what God has willed, what God has planned. I only know at His right hand stands one who is my Savior. I take Him at His word indeed. Christ died to save me, this I read. And in my heart I find a need of Him to be my Savior. That He would leave His place on high and come for sinful men to die. Did I, before I knew my Savior? My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God, He's always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God, He's always gonna be. Yes, living, dying, let me bring my strength, my solace from this spring. That He who lives to be my King once died to be my Savior. That He would leave His place on high and come for sinful men to die. You count it strange, so once did I, before I knew my Savior. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God, He's always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God, He's always gonna be. Thank you. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God, He's always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God, He's always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God, He's always gonna be.
Amen. Thank you, Ronnie. Thank you, Danny. That's a great word, too, isn't it? My Savior lives. And He is always there for us. Okay. Thanks, Danny. All right. Great word. Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you. And thank you, church. I tell you, it's indeed an honor to be able to gather together in His name and sing His praises and worship our Heavenly Father. So thank y'all so much. Turn, if you will, to the fourth chapter of James, and while you're turning there, I have a question for you, okay? I'm trying to make these easy questions, but I have several questions for you during the message today, so be ready to at least raise a hand, okay? How many of you have ever been to Disney World? That's the one in Orlando, not the one in California, okay? A lot of us have, not all of us, but a lot of us have, right? I love Disney. I love Disney World. I know... We weren't, growing up in the church in the 80s, we weren't supposed to like Disney very much, but I never really quite understood that one, I tell you, because I love Disney. It's a fun place. I went a lot growing up because it was a really favored spot for band trips in the 80s and 90s, at least. I went 3 times as a band student, 1 time as a student teacher, and I took my own band there as a band director once. So I spent a lot of time in my teenage years in Orlando. Melissa and I have been at least 2 times. And, you know, it's just one of those places I enjoy to be. I guess I like to be a kid. But one of my earliest memories of Disney, I was probably about 5 or 6 years old, and my parents took the whole family to Disney, and I remember several things about this trip. First of all, I remember being in the parking lot of our hotel, which was on Disney property, and the axle on the car broke. I was excited because that meant we could spend a couple of extra days in the park while the car got fixed. My dad wasn't quite as excited about that, and I never really quite understood why until I had my own car to pay for repairs for. But I tell you, you know, it was exciting, and we got to go there, and, you know, I remember, you know, this ride, this one particular ride called the Jungle Cruise. I don't know if you've ever been on that one before. It's one of the longest running rides at Disney. It was there from day one when they opened, and it's still open today. Well, as soon as the park opens back up, it will still be in operation today. And it's really kind of a cheesy ride, but I was, you know, 5 or 6 years old. I enjoyed it. There were all these animatronic animals along the sides of the river, elephants spraying water everywhere, hippopotami, I guess that's plural of hippopotamus, and crocodiles swimming along in the water, and a lot of cheesy jokes by the guy who was up by the wheel claiming to be the skipper, giving us our guided tour. And as we were closing down towards the end of the ride, you could see the dock where the boat was going to come alongside and that we were going to get off of that boat. He looked down at me and said, "You want to put us in?" I'm like, "Really?" And so he said, "Yeah, come on up." So I got to go up there, and I was steering that boat. And I said, "Man, I tell you, I had never driven anything before. I mean, except maybe my parents crazy. But I had never really driven any vehicle before. And here I am piloting this boat with people on it. And I tell you, I did a great job. Brought it right up alongside that pier. I didn't run into the pier. I didn't miss the pier. I mean, it was perfect. Right there, tied off. Everybody got off. And I was proud of myself for years until I went back as a teenager. And I saw that boat was on a track below the water. I was doing nothing but spinning a wheel that looked like a steering wheel. And the reality is I had absolutely no control over that boat. But I sure did think I did. You ever had that feeling? You thought you were in control, but in reality, not so much. All right, let me ask this another way. Who is in control of your life? And here's just a little hint. If you think it's you, if you think it's your spouse, if you think it's your finances, if you think it's your job, no, none of that. Who's in control of your life? God. 100% God. James alludes to that here in the fourth chapter of James. I'm going to start reading in verse 13. It says, "Come now, you who say, today or tomorrow we will travel to such and such a city and spend a year there and do business and make a profit. You don't even know what tomorrow will bring, what your life will be. For you're like smoke that appears for a little while and then vanishes. Instead, you should say, if the Lord wills, we will live and do this or that. But as it is, you boast in your arrogance. All such boasting is evil. So it is a sin for the person who knows to do what is good and doesn't do it." Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we love you, Lord, and we again just thank you for the opportunity to dive into your word, Lord. I pray, Father, that you will help us to see and understand. Speak to our hearts, Lord. Help us. Change us, Lord, so that we can be more like you. I pray, Father, you will hide this man behind your cross and speak through these lips of clay. Not my words, Lord, but yours. It's in your holy, wonderful, and amazing name we pray. Amen. As is common in James, here goes James giving us some really practical advice, right? He spells it out quite clearly and honestly quite bluntly and tells us about how to plan for the future. And again, as typical of James, not only is he blunt, he tells us what we don't need to be doing, but he also tells us what we do need to be doing. But first, he starts off by teaching us, by telling us what not to do. There's three things here, three sins, if you will, in this passage that tell us what not to do. First of all, in verses 13 and 14, you have the sin of presumption. Verse 13 again reads, "Come now, you who say today and tomorrow, we will travel to such and such a city and spend a year there and do business and make a profit." That's presumptuous is what James is saying. What does presumptuous mean? Well, that means kind of arrogant, right? You're kind of going to assume whatever you say goes. Is that the way life works? Not at all. Now, James is not saying by any means not to make plans. Yes, we're supposed to plan, right? We have to plan. This world that we live in is way, way too complicated. I mean, how many of you here keep a calendar, either written or sometimes typed with your thumbs or whatever on your device, right? I keep a calendar because if anything is out of the ordinary in my schedule, I need to write it down or I'll forget. That's making plans. Is it okay to make plans? Absolutely, it's okay to make plans. But here's the deal. Who's in charge, your calendar or God? And the answer is obviously God. And that is obvious, but it can sometimes be difficult. What we need to do is, James is telling us, we need to check the attitude of our plans. How do we approach our plans, okay? We need to get the attitudes of our plans in check. And so James tells us we need to do two things right. First, we need to have the proper view of the future. James 4:14 says, "You don't even know what tomorrow will bring." Can I get an amen? Because I tell you, if I have to convince you of that truth right now, where our world is right now, we're in trouble. Because life has done a much better job of making that point than I ever could. I mean, you know, James is pointing out here kind of an uncomfortable truth, all right? The reality is I don't know what tomorrow brings. Now, as a Christian, I know exactly where I'll be 1,000 years from now, or even 1,000,000 years from now, because I know once I'm done with this life, I'm going to be in heaven with him forever. And no, I can't really wrap my brain around the concept of forever, but I know God's got me. And I know I'm going to be with him, so no matter what happens, what it looks like, it's going to be good. All right? I know that. I know that with every fiber of my being. How do I know that? Because I know God's got his hands on me. He has told me about this in his word, and I count on it. But I don't know what tomorrow will bring. I don't know what this afternoon's going to bring. I am just as certain that I don't know what's coming tomorrow as I am being certain if I know what's coming in 1,000 years. And again, that's kind of uncomfortable for us because I'm a plan to work, work to plan kind of guy, right? I like to make myself lists, and there are post-it notes everywhere in my life. And when I get done with them, I take great joy in wadding those things up and throwing them away because I'm done with that one, right? But life isn't always that neat and clean, is it? I mean, on one level, we do understand this. How many of you ever check the weather before you go out? Right? I got two weather apps on my phone. But I know for absolute certain there's a decent chance that weather report's going to be wrong, right? So even if it says only a 10% chance of rain, you know what I still have in my truck? An umbrella. Why? Because I make contingency plans knowing that that might not be correct information. And we need to do the same things with every plan we make. We need to plan like it's all up to us, and we need to allow God to interrupt our plans at any given moment. And for me, I got to be honest with you, that's difficult. Proverbs 27:1, don't boast about tomorrow, for you do not know what a day might bring. Have no idea what a day might bring. Most of us live like we're in absolute complete control. You know, everything from housework to homework. Once we plan it, it might as well, it's going to happen, right? Because I planned it, so it's going to happen. Is that really the way life works? No, not at all. Our second thing that James tells us here in the second half of verse 14, he says we need to take a hard look at how we view ourselves. For you are like smoke that appears for a little while, then vanishes. That's kind of humbling, isn't it? I don't know about you, I don't like to really think about that. I'm kind of the star of my life, right? And I think we're all that way, at least to an extent, aren't we? I mean, it's really easy for us to get into that little mindset where we're a little more self-important. We're a little more important to ourselves than we actually are. All right, let me prove my point here. How many of you here know the name of your great-grandfather? First name. Okay, there are a few hands up, but not many, right? Far more don't know than do know. And this is somebody who was living and breathing decades ago. His blood is coursing through your veins. Yet how quickly do we forget? Part of that to me is very sad, right? I mean, I know my grandparents' names, my great-grandparents, that's a little fuzzy. Once you get further out into the family tree, it gets a little more fuzzy. But those are the people who my success in my life is in part built upon. How quickly this world moves on. In middle school, I had a writing assignment, and it was really kind of deep thoughts for a 13-year-old. But I was assigned to, here's the question I was supposed to ponder. Let's say it's 40 years from now, you're retired, you've been successful in life, and somebody wants to write a biography on you. And the assignment was, what is the title of your biography? What do you want people to think of when they think of you? Well, according to James here, a good title for our biography might be Smoke. Appeared for a while, then vanished. Again, that's pretty humbling, isn't it? I want to have more of an impact on my world than simply to be thought of as mist or smoke. I want to have more of an impact on the people that I encounter because I want to impact people for Jesus, not because I want to impact them for Nash. I don't need to be remembered. I'm okay with that. All right, you know, 100 years from now, my name might be on that plaque back there if Jesus hadn't come back yet as serving as your pastor for a period of time, and that's fine. But more important than that, I want to be remembered. You know how I want to be remembered? I want to be remembered as one who brings people into the presence of God. I want to be remembered not for the things I did on this earth except for introducing people to Jesus Christ. I want my heavenly footprint, so to speak, to have residence up there more so than down here. That's how we need to focus. That's how we need to plan our days. That's how we need to schedule ourselves. That needs to be our focus because everything here is temporary. Everything here is temporary. Again, that's not something we like to think about. But I worked hard on that. Yeah, I'm sure you did, but it's still temporary. The only things that are eternal are things of God. That does count for both directions now, if you're pushing people towards or away from God. That's eternal. And I don't know about you, but I want to be known for bringing people into His presence in everything that I do. You know, again, I'm not saying this to make you feel insignificant or unimportant. I don't think that's the message of the gospel at all. If you ever feel insignificant or if you ever feel unimportant, all you need to do is take a look at the cross of Christ. and you'll know somebody in this existence loved you enough to die for your sins. We are all significant in God's eyes. But at the same time, we also need to realize the sun doesn't rise and set because of our importance. We commit the sin of presumption when we think too highly of ourselves and assume our plans to be fact. You see, presumption denies who we are, denies who God is, and denies how much we need God day by day, moment by moment. The proper attitude towards life and towards our plans is to live as if life is a gift from God, which comes by His love and His mercy, because it's true. So we don't need to be presumptuous about our plans. Second thing, over in verse 16, James is telling us about the sin of boasting. Verse 16 says, "But as it is, you boast in your arrogance. All such boasting is evil." Again, James kind of lays it out there, doesn't he? What do you think he feels about boasting? Do you think he's wishy-washy on this? No, not at all. It is evil, okay? And again, if we dig in and really look at the original language in this, we see some things. This word for boasting is alazonia, okay? And it's the root word points towards behavior that some would use to describe a snake oil salesman. Have you ever heard that term before? Well, you know, a snake oil salesman is one. It's a term that kind of came into popularity, I guess you would say, at the end of the 1800s when people were traveling the country selling cures for everything that ails you. What's the difference in a doctor and a snake oil salesman? A lot, yeah. The snake oil salesman's cures don't really cure anything, do they? Again, I've told you before, we're a fan of the Andy Griffith Show at my house. And you remember there was an episode where Aunt Bee bought some tonic. And that tonic was supposed to be a cure for a midlife crisis. Because Aunt Bee was wondering why, if she was really all that important, what was she accomplishing with her life? And in rolls to town this guy and sells her some tonic. Do you remember what that tonic actually was? 170 proof, that's what it was. It was some pretty potent liquor. And it licked her. Was she concerned about her midlife? No, she wasn't concerned about much of anything. Why? Because she was drunk. Was that really a cure? No, not at all. A snake oil salesman is one who makes promises that he can't deliver on. And that's what we are when we boast. Well, it's not bragging if you can back it up. Really? Yeah, it is. It really is. Because again, you don't know what tomorrow brings. You can say, well, I can do this, but you don't know if you're going to be able to do it then. You don't know if you're going to be able to do it right now. The reality is it's all in God's hands. What does this have to do with planning to the future? Well, again, we can't claim something we don't have, which includes the power to determine the course of our own lives. And what does James call this boasting? He says it's evil. Again, the Greek word there is poneros. It's used a lot in the Bible. It's the exact same word that's found in the Lord's Prayer for when Jesus told the disciples to pray that he will deliver us from evil. So basically, James here is saying boasting is from the devil. Boasting is absolute evil. So do we need to be doing that? No, because you're not in control. Neither am I. The only thing I'm going to boast on is Jesus Christ, because his work is finished. It is finished for my behalf, on my behalf. That is the only thing that we can boast on. Again, this might seem harsh, but we just need to remember, anytime we take upon ourselves something that is really in God's purview, something that an authority that belongs to God, we are being evil. So we don't need to do that. Of all times in history, I shouldn't really have to work very hard to convince you that your plans can be interrupted by God at any moment. I mean, back in January 1st, when we celebrated the new year going into 2020, did anybody have written on their plans for the month of April to be social distancing, washing your hands like crazy, wearing a mask anytime you were in public, and staying home. Because if you did, I want to see the rest of your 2020 calendar too to see what's coming up next. I got some questions. But the reality is, no, none of us knew this was coming except God. So we have got to be plugged in to the source. That is the only way. That is the only way that this will work. So in addition to the sin of presumption, in addition to the sin of boasting, James also has the sin of omission. Let me tell you, this one hits me hard. Verse 17. What does verse 17 tell us? So it is a sin for the person who knows to do what is good and does not do it. You know, omission is not really one of these words that we use very frequently, but it's basically leaving something out, neglecting to do something. That's omitting it, omission. The sin of omission is by far the most difficult form of sin to deal with in the human heart. And I also think it's one of the most pervasive right now. Because here's the deal. Sin, right? Sin, the Greek term for sin, we know this is an archery term. You've heard teachings on this before, I'm sure. It's an archery term for missing the mark, not hitting what you are aiming for. All right, that's kind of the literal definition of the Greek word that we translate sin. And it's easy for us to see and teach children that doing something wrong is a sin. That's real easy. That doesn't take a leap in logic. What's a more difficult lesson for us to see and to teach our children is that not doing something that we know is the right thing to do is just as wrong. James, all throughout this book, is trying to teach us to be doers and not hearers only, right? He said this at least twice in the book, and right here he's alluding to the very same thing. Because what good does it do you if you know all of this and do none of it? No earthly good at all, and no heavenly good at all either. One of my seminary profs, I think this was a quote from somebody else, but I'm not sure, said, I'm much more concerned about doing what I know than learning more. Because the reality is, most of us know this better than our behavior shows. And that breaks God's heart. To know what is right and then not to do it is a form of disobedience. When God gives us a command and we simply either ignore it or fail to do it, we are in sin. As Danny read earlier, the parable of the talents, Matthew 25, 14 through 30, is really this exact example, okay? The master goes away for an extended period of time and leaves talents, which is a unit of money, right? A fairly significant amount of money. He gives one servant 5 talents, one servant 2 talents, one servant 1 talent, and goes away on a long journey. When he comes back, the one with 5 has doubled it. Now he's got 10. Is the master pleased? Yes. Another servant had 2. Now he has 4. Is the master pleased? Yes. And the final one had 1 and said, I know you're a hard man. And I know you wouldn't want me to lose your money, so I buried it in a coffee can in the backyard, and here it is. Here's your money back. He didn't do what his master instructed him to do, did he? He was disobedient in his inaction. And the same trap is there for us today. The problem is we know what God wants us to do. We know that we should be doing it, but oftentimes when it comes to that point of time to do the work of the Lord, what do we say? My schedule's full. We make time and room to do what we need to make time to do what we've been called to do. So what does this look like in reality? And again, I'm preaching to the choir, but I was a minister of music for a long time, so I'm used to doing that. What does this look like in reality? Becoming more and more irregular in your church attendance. Not because of pandemic, so Facebook family, I'm not talking to you. I just mean thinking, well, it's not really worth my time. We must make meeting with God's people a priority or it will not happen. Spending daily time with God, spending time in His Word, spending time with Him in prayer. You might sometimes say to yourself, I mean, have you ever heard this before? I've got so much going on right now. Maybe when things slow down, I'll be able to do that. When are things going to slow down? If it's up to us, no time soon. Maybe we're not serving the people God has placed around us as we ought to be. I mean, you know, our family just gets the kind of leftovers of our time, and this reflects a sin in our planning. Maybe we've already made something else our priority and planned around that. We shouldn't have reflected on God's will by making something else more important. What we're being driven by should matter the most. Our worldly desires have oftentimes exposed the shallowness of our faith. Now, am I talking to you? I don't know. But I know there are a lot of people in this world right now that describes very well. By the time we try to fit some Christian stuff into our calendars, many times we say, well, it's full. Shouldn't God's things be the first thing in your plans? That's what His Word tells us. That's what His sacrifice on the cross tells us. But a lot of times that's not what our behavior communicates. I know this is a hard word, but the good that we should be doing is left undone oftentimes, and that is sinful. So what's the message of this? Look for opportunities to serve God. And when these opportunities present themselves, what should we do if we already had something else penciled in on our calendar? Follow the opportunities God gives us, not the plans that we made. I'll be honest, this is something I really struggled with, especially when I first went into ministry. When I first went into full-time ministry, I'd been a youth minister, music minister full-time for about 6 months, and I was talking to my brother, kind of complaining. It's like, I can't get anything done. It's been one of those kind of weeks where I have things I got to get done. I have services to plan. I got youth lessons to plan. I need to spend some time in the Word so I can teach, but stuff keeps coming up. My brother said in a tremendous amount of wisdom that I didn't recognize at the time, but I do now. He said, well, whose schedule is it anyway, Nash? Yours or God's? This stuff that's coming up were ministry opportunities. So is it okay to lay down my plans to go minister in God's name? Absolutely it is. As a matter of fact, that should be the norm, not the exception. And all of us need to leave our schedules open enough to take advantage of the opportunities God gives us to serve Him. So if you make an appointment with me and I might have to call you and say, you know, I'm not going to be able to make it. I don't want to do that. I don't want to let people down. But the reality is, if God tells me to go do something else, guess what? And same thing, if you have an opportunity to serve when you're supposed to come talk to me, please serve the Lord. I mean, call me and let me know, but serve the Lord. Because we have got to allow Him full sway in our schedules. Okay, Nash, you've told us a lot of things how we can mess this up, but you said James said something in here about what we should be doing. Yes, what we should be doing is found back in verse 15. Verse 15 tells us, instead, you should say, if the Lord wills, we will live and do this or that. Instead of presuming or boasting or missing the mark by failing to do God's will, we should commit ourselves to the Lord to doing His will. And our planning should be based upon this conviction that our lives and our future are not our own, but they belong to the Lord. Now, what James is saying here and what God is saying here isn't just simply to tack a, if God wills, on the end of every single plan we make. No, this isn't about a slogan. This is about a relationship with your Savior. We need to have that heart set that whatever God brings me to is what I need to be about. I mean, it would be really easy to slip into this, but it's not about what we say in as much as it's about our attitude and our heart set. How do we handle and how do we approach things like this? You know, we should live with absolute utter dependence upon the sovereign will of God in our lives, and our future belongs to Him, and our present belongs to Him also. Everything we do should be filtered through our relationship with Jesus Christ. So what does godly planning look like? Well, the godly response to a plan in a way that recognizes and remembers that we are not in ultimate control. And that if we plan and conceive everything that we want to do, we got to give God permission and even invite him to step in and mess with our plans. Proverbs 16:9, a man's heart plans his way, but the Lord determines his steps. Again, God's not saying don't make a plan. That's not what James is saying. That's not what God wants us to do. We need to set goals. We need to figure out ways to get from where we are to where we want to be. That's good. That is things that we should be doing. But every plan we make needs to be able to be interrupted by God. I am not the master of my own destiny. I'm not the skipper of my own soul. It's just like that boat that I sat in front of Disney World and spun that wheel that did absolutely nothing. Because the reality is, God is in control, not me. From the outside looking in, giving up this level of control is really, honestly, it's terrifying. I'm kind of a control kind of person, right? Thank you, Melissa, for not amening that one. I like to be in control. I do. I'm a type A kind of guy, but you know what? I'm not. I'm not in control of anything. He is. After all, we live in the land of the free and the home of the brave, right? The epicenter of the self-made man. That's the American way, right? It's not God's way. I am not a self-made man. Anything positive that I have in my life is God-made. Anything negative in my life, I'll claim it. The only thing I'm capable of making is a mess. Or being obedient to him. Then we can leave a legacy that lasts, because it's a legacy that lasts in heaven. And only then. That's the kind of legacy I want to leave. We've got to remember, God has a plan. God's plan is what's best for my life and what's best for your life. So instead of guessing and trying to stumble upon what is best, why don't we give the master the free hand in our own lives? Why not give him control over everything, our schedule, our plans, our future, all of it? See, he wants to give us that hope for tomorrow. He wants what's best for us. And so if we trust him, can we trust God? Absolutely, we can trust God. Therefore, what he says is best. For some of you hearing this, you might be thinking, Nash, you're nuts. There's no way I'd give up that kind of control. That's not how I'm wired. That's not how God made me. Have you ever used that excuse before? I have. But the reality is, that's exactly how God made us. He made us dependent upon him. Next month, we celebrate a holiday, right? July 4th. What's another name for that holiday? Independence Day, right? Sorry, Danny. Yeah. But the reality is, every single day of my life, I want to celebrate Dependence Day, because I am dependent upon him for everything. And that's because I have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. That is the only reason. Okay, because it goes against everything that I feel in my head, not in my heart, that I'm supposed to be master of my own destiny. I'm supposed to be the one in control, but I'm not. Why? Because he is. And until we admit that we can't do this on our own, until we admit that we need God's help, we'll never understand this concept. Until we believe that Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, came and died for us on that cross, paid a sin debt that we could not pay, until we get to that place, none of this makes sense. Because once we admit it and once we believe what Christ did for us, then we're in a position in that perfect personal relationship with God through the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. We're in the position to be able to give him control. Because it makes no earthly sense to give up that much control unless you have a solid, trusting relationship to base that upon.
And that's my invitation to all of us. That's my challenge to each and every one of us today. All right, acknowledge what we already know. Acknowledge that God is in control. Acknowledge that God's ways are best. And ask God to show you. Ask Him to show you where you're missing the mark, either in what you're doing wrong or what you're not doing that you ought to be. Because I guarantee you, when we ask God that question, He will have an answer. He will show you where. He will show you how. And the reality is, there's no better place that any of us can be than totally and completely dependent upon Him. Because when we're dependent upon Him, that puts us in the center of His will for our lives. That's what God wants from us. Sometimes God drops bricks on our heads, right? Sometimes He kind of rattles our cage a little bit. Sometimes He's going to grab me by the lapels and shake me a little bit. But often, it's way more subtle than that. Because the reality of it is, God is calling us with that still, small voice. He is calling us and pleading us to come to Him. And He wouldn't be asking us to do that if it wasn't what's best for us. Because He knows what's best for us better than we can even imagine. Because He knows what we're going to need tomorrow and the next day and the next week and the next month. I don't. And if we're honest, we don't either. Again, if ever there was a time in history that shows us how little control we really have, it's now. Because a virus smaller than we can see has chased us inside. Anger so big we can't ignore has caused such disruption in our world. And what's the solution to both of these situations? Jesus. So respond to the still small voice of God and be the agent God uses to point those around you to Him. It's that simple, yet it's that hard too. But if we'll trust in God, He will give us the words, He will give us the courage, and He will give us the power to accomplish what He has called us to do. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we love You, Lord, and we again just thank You. Thank You, Lord, for holding us in the palm of Your hand. Thank You, Father, for knowing what's best for us, for knowing not only our present, but knowing our future as well. Father, help us to be obedient to You in all that we do. Help us, Lord, to turn over control. Because our control is really an illusion anyway. You are in ultimate control of everything, Father. And I thank You. Help us, Lord. Help us to put You first. Help us, Lord, to dwell in You. Help us to be obedient to all that You have called us to do. It's in Your holy, wonderful, and amazing name we pray, Lord. Amen. Hymn of invitation, and during this hymn, again, the altar is open. We would love to have you come and pray, but you can do business with God right where you are to respond to that still, small voice.
Watching for